creating reality through thought. That is our topic today. Welcome to the Matrixers, Jonathan and Shiva. Yes, interpretations create our reality. That will now be our topic today. As always, we think it's a very exciting because that too is part or even the main part that makes up our matrix, so to speak. By creating our matrix, our world around us, with our beliefs and our interpretations of what other people say and what they say, and what is happening on the outside. Our interpretations create our reality, our own personal matrix. Yes, how is our reality created? Today we divide this into 4 points: reality construction, reality strengthening, reality creation, and reality changes, i.e., alternation or the change between realities. These are our 4 points today, which we will work through one after the other. Personal reality is created by beliefs, opinions, interpretations, and beliefs. The mind will store an interpreted situation, and then it is the prover of that action. That is, the mind will then use the filter to interpret reality as pertinent to previous interpretations. That is what it means. Actually, your past creates your current reality. At some point, you have adopted your upbringing, school, job, beliefs from your parents. Something like money stinks or money is dirty. And at some point, if a belief is repeated enough times, from all sorts of perspectives, it becomes a belief. And at some point you have the conviction, yes, money. Money is not good, money can never be good. Money is bad, and then that belief is so ingrained in you that your whole reality is based on this belief that money is bad. And you will always have trouble in your life, for example, making money, finding a good job, building something nice for yourself, just because you were constantly told this or because your parents were maybe poor and said, yes, money is bad or you have to earn money hard. And that would be a simple example of how to create a reality by repeating it over and over again and using the same filter of the mind to create your current reality over and over again. Recreating from the past what you just learned. And with that in mind, we've prepared a little intro for you. Ah yes, exactly. Then maybe you can get an idea of what today's video is about. You, Jonathan. Why are all the birds sitting on the power line? These are Wi-Fi birds. Hey, what are Wi-Fi birds? They sit on the power line so they can charge themselves. These are Wi-Fi birds. Oh, nonsense. Now don't lie. But it's true. You've probably seen a dead bird before, haven't you? Yes, I have. Do you see? And it hadn't charged up in time. Hutch. With this intro, you could clearly see that especially when you are young or younger, as a child, you always have a lot of questions. Children ask many questions. They eventually get into this phase where they pester the parents with questions. Why? Why is that? Surely some of you know that. And that's where the child begins to build a belief system. A belief system is a set of beliefs. And the beliefs are just interpreted situations. and these interpretations then become beliefs, and a group of beliefs then become a belief system. And this system supports each other. Contradictions are then mostly excluded and then form our reality, or then influence the perception of our reality. One can perhaps also observe this in a discussion. Yes. In a discussion, everyone says what they believe in, how they interpret a certain situation, and the other interprets it differently. And then a heated debate quickly ensues. Although one may have meant something completely different than the other interpreted. And yes, that is always so loaded with potential for conflict. One interprets through one's own filters quite differently than someone else meant it. Yes, I always find the term soul a good example. Yes, for example, two people are talking about the soul, about the immortality of the soul, whether there is a soul, etc. etc. But the term soul is interpreted and defined differently. For some, the soul is what leaves the body after death. We are actually talking about the astral body. So this person interprets that the soul is the same as the astral body. A different interpretation of the soul would be a part of the original source. Exactly. The immortal soul that has just come to earth and incarnated here. And this different interpretation always provides a topic for discussion, because everyone interprets the term soul differently. The point is that a dispute then arises, because each soul interprets it differently. But both use the same term, and the discussion is actually inevitable, although many of those involved in the discussion view it the same way, so to speak, but only have a definition for other words. Yes, another real-life example would be, honey, I'll go get some cigarettes, and the woman doesn't think anything of it. She interprets it like he's just going to get cigarettes. But the man's intention was never to come back. A perhaps even more practical example. Honey, we still have 5,000 euros on the account. The intention of the man, or the mind behind it, is, God is that little. But the woman interprets, wow, 5,000 euros, and then that's two different interpretations of a situation. For just 5,000 euros. The woman thinks that's a lot. The man finds that very little. A dispute can then arise very quickly. We have to work more. We have to save more. We have to. The woman says it's all good, just chill. So there is a discrepancy in interpretation. Yes, and then you can think about how many terms there are in our dictionary and how they are interpreted differently. And that's why, in a discussion, you can say that 80% of the time you're actually only arguing because you're just interpreting the terms used in the discussion differently. That's why we suggest that we ask questions in a discussion. Yeah, hey, how do you actually interpret soul? What is soul for you? What do you mean by that? Yes, that you can maybe adjust that a bit. And yes. And of course Shiva's amusing example of fetching cigarettes. Yes, you can see how easy it is to interpret something. You can interpret something as harmless, interpret something as unpleasant or dangerous. Quite different, regardless of that. It's always important to look for yourself. How do I interpret something? Does the other person really mean what he said? Or did he perhaps interpret it completely differently? that ensures that we interpret a certain situation and then build up a causal belief. The best example is still the stovetop. If I touch a hotplate that's on, I'll burn my fingers. It's very classic. And that is causality. Whenever, then and there. Most interpretations or beliefs are actually based on this principle. At some point, an interpretation becomes a belief, in which the mind has collected enough evidence for the interpretation that it then becomes a belief. But that doesn't mean that the mind is absolutely capable of correctly interpreting a situation. The mind's job is to indicate different realities that are so in the environment, and it lists all these realities. And then at some point you start to decide on a reality, on an interpretation, and stick to it. Once you've made that decision, it's the mind's job again to reinforce the interpreted reality with further interpretations that go along with it, that conform to it. Yes. As I said, a belief system builds up over years and becomes more and more solid. So you can also call it a construct. A close interweaving of different beliefs, and the more beliefs are added, the stronger this construct, the beliefs, becomes. Every belief you repeat, over and over, creates a neuronal connection in the brain. And the more often you do that, the stronger this neuron connection becomes. And the more points are added to this belief. Let's say we take veganism. Just because someone says vegetarian is healthy doesn't make you decide to become a vegetarian. Or just because someone tells you eating meat is healthy doesn't make you go from vegetarian to meat eater. It takes a construct, an overall package, so to speak, a beliefs, an entire system that convinces you to become one or the other. And when that construct is large enough and stable, solidified with enough evidence for the mind, then you will follow this or that reality and walk that path. But then it is all the more difficult to smash such a construct. Say, suddenly becoming a meat eater, even though you were a vegetarian, because the construct is so solidified and built up so huge that it's very difficult to cut all these connections again and build a new complete system. That's actually the problem in our world. I think we have, a person could fill books with their beliefs. You can't just take the main belief. A main belief also includes many small secondary beliefs that underpin the main belief. It's hard to make a lot of money like that. And there is a huge construct to this small belief. And we have beliefs on every subject. So I think we could really fill books with our beliefs. Yes, of course. And people keep writing to us and saying, I want to be a millionaire. I need a million in my account. And then they start to go to bed at night and build up the belief. I have €1 million in my account starting tomorrow or in a month. Yes. The problem is that this belief is not part of a belief system, it just stands on its own. So that means this belief has far too little energy to actually ensure that you have €1 million in your bank account next month. In addition, the mind also lacks the evidence. Yes, I just wanted to mention that. Because then the mind lacks the justification. Where does the million come from? Exactly. Then who transfers the million? Because the name that sent you the million should be on the bank account. And who should that be? And why should he do that? All of this information is missing from the belief, and that is why you need a belief package where all of these questions are cleared up for the mind. And then it works with the million. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult to apply this single belief and also to attract the reality in which it then behaves as one would like it to be. There's the trick, of course, in feeling like you're already a millionaire. But then of course you have to quiet your mind for quite a while so it doesn't keep going back to the old beliefs. Of course you can then take the new belief, I'll be a millionaire tomorrow, and feel how you spend all that money as a millionaire. But that's the way it is. It also has to be practiced. And of course you have to be willing to quiet the mind, for example through dissociation, so that it doesn't keep reinterpreting and presenting all the other beliefs that oppose your new belief. Yes, right, because when you use your mind to attract a certain reality, to build a belief, solidify it, and then translate it into reality, and use your mind to help you do that, you have to create a whole package of beliefs that justify everything that. Happens next. Where does the money come from? Who was so nice and the like, etc. And only with dissociation would it be possible, namely to switch off the mind temporarily, so that it has no chance of interpreting anything, so that one then attracts the reality that already exists. An alternate reality where the desired amount is in the account. And yes, when you wake up in the morning or come out of the dissociation, you can check your account and the amount should be there. Quite simply because you then switched reality directly into an alternative reality. Because, in terms of the existence of alternate realities, in one reality, your favorite soccer team lost. But in the other reality, she won. Yes. In the other reality was undecided. And in another reality, a storm suddenly came and the game had to be called off. So there are many alternate realities. Variations on the reality you are in and experiencing right now. And in this respect, it is the case that theoretically every reality is possible for the subconscious. But the mind, of course, filters out everything that doesn't agree with one's own belief system due to the beliefs that have been built up in the course of one's own life. That's why dissociation is so important, of course. And to create realities, it is definitely helpful or elementary to have trust. Trust in the dissociation. Trust that the process will work. Trust that you also create the reality you desire, that you also have the ability. So no self-doubt. They are also very difficult to do. But through these dissociations, you calm your mind in this respect as well. So self-doubt is a hindrance. Trust is good, and of course gratitude is also a key to being thankful for it. First for what is there, and second for what you will soon have. Yes, often the result of interpreted reality feels like it happened subconsciously. Say it feels like it happened to you. For example, if we don't like the reality you're in right now, you are dissatisfied with your job, with your partnership, with your environment, with your house, with your financial status. then it feels to you as if you didn't consciously decide that and didn't consciously manifest it. It feels like that happened. These are the circumstances of life that got you there. But that's not the case. It just feels subconscious. In reality, however, it is exactly the other way around. In any case, every decision you make is intentionally made that way, even if it doesn't seem like it. And I always like to say belief is a matter of taste. We only believe what we like. If someone tells us something and says you can believe me, it's like this and that, then it's not a question of whether that's true. It's really the truth that he says, or whether it's just nonsense what he's saying. But we measure what we believe in and how we want to interpret something based on our taste, not physical taste, but whether it's us. Like that. Because if we don't like something, then we tend very strongly not to believe it either. And that's why faith does not serve to find the truth, but only for personal spiritual taste. Whether we like something or not. After all, who believes something that they don't like at all or that doesn't suit them or that simply doesn't appeal to them? It's very rare that that happens. And on this point, you have to check your own beliefs. What do I want to believe? And how is it really? Of course, with the interpretive help of the mind, you can create your reality the way you want. You interpret a situation and then you learn to interpret each situation based on the main interpretation and thus to create reality. It is also the case that when you interpret your reality and you do not like your reality, even though you have made a conscious decision, you make decisions in your life all the time, every day, whether small or big, in which job you take, where you move to, whether you drink coffee or water. However, everything is a choice and each choice leads you down a path to where you are right now. And if you don't like it, even if you say so, it's unconscious. I did not want. Did you consciously, yes, decide to take the decision that got you into this situation? And yes, in the event that we don't like something, we tend very quickly to become victims and perpetrators in our thinking and behavior, instead of taking responsibility for the situation we are in at the moment. Yes, that's the point. The important point in the whole story, namely that the perpetrator and the victim think. As a perpetrator, you often get a bad conscience in quotation marks perpetrator that you have done something where another person has suffered damage. And as a victim, what happens when you look at a situation as a victim? For example, you get an additional payment for your electricity bill from the tax office. Or the tax office would like to have a few thousand more, because they still want to build a tank somewhere, have it installed, or what other story I don't know. And in this respect, it is of course the case that the victim position that one takes in a certain life situation, naturally undermines one's own creative energy. How could this happen to me? Yes, and as soon as you undermine your own creator energy, the creator energy becomes more unconscious at the moment. You no longer really have conscious access to it because you are distancing yourself from your creator in that moment. And this distancing from his creative power can only take place in a victim position. For a creator creates his reality. And it is not the case that others create his reality. No, because You are the creator yourself, and therefore you should also take responsibility for your creations and say, I created it that way and nobody else, because I am the creator. And then, in that regard, going into a victim position is inconvenient, because a victim position just says, no, I didn't create that. I don't have the creative power to create something like that, and I don't like what I've created either. So you don't believe that you created it yourself, and of course the assumption then arises that it happened subconsciously, without your own doing. We do it quite often with our fellow human beings, that we force them into the victim role by saying, oh, poor thing, I have pity, but in this case we also undermine their creative power. We present ourselves as the big one and he's the poor one who can't get it together and can't get it done because he's a poor victim and not a creator. That's the whole victim-perpetrator thing. It's difficult. But important. Yes, you have to clarify that within yourself. Identify the perpetrator in yourself and also the victim. And then, of course, check it properly. The perpetrator quickly has a bad conscience, then he thinks he has to fix something. Again, and that is usually the motive for billions of new incarnations. Yes, and the victim position, on the other hand, naturally undermines one's own creative power, and that's why it needs to be checked. Because a creator being is actually always a doer. Yes, actually already, only without that negative connotation that one might associate with the term perpetrator. No, he is actually a constructive doer, the creator being. And so it is important that you identify this part in yourself. And if something goes wrong, it always happens again. After all, a creator being is not endlessly perfect. And if something goes wrong, then take responsibility for it. Say, okay, I didn't do it so well. Smile about it once. Yes. Even if it's not so great that you then think, yes, I didn't manage that very well. It will be better next time. Exactly. But there are no mistakes in that sense and one must not forget that. Because of that I didn't manage that well. Everything is intentional. So out of oneself is intention. There are no mistakes per se. It is then interpreted as an error. I didn't do that well. That brings us back to duality. Good and bad. Negative. Positive. So, even if you say or interpret, you didn't do that well. That was a mistake. That's not entirely correct either. But it definitely helps to take more responsibility. Of course, that had or still has a very negative aftertaste in society. Well, I've talked to a lot of people who say, yes, responsibility. Yes, you are responsible. You might hear it at work or something. You're responsible that we've lost a million here now. So even the word responsibility has a very negative connotation. Many already have a very big problem with this, which is a pity, because responsibility has to do with the creator and not with obligation or with you or to blame. Actually, they tell you. Actually, people don't tell you you're responsible, it's your fault. And there's a big difference between responsibility and guilt. Yes, and here we have the problem that we mentioned at the beginning, the concept of responsibility. Because responsibility is also a question of how one interprets this term. Because some understand responsibility as having a job, having a roof over your head and having a family. So obligation. Yeah, right. So that has a negative connotation for some. They might then think, no, I don't want that much responsibility. That's right. And we're not talking about this responsibility. We're talking about the self-responsibility of a creator being. That is, one only takes responsibility for oneself and regards the reality, the everyday reality in which one finds oneself as the personal creation for which one should learn to take responsibility. That's why it's very important, because it's quite possible that some of you might react to the words we used, like the word responsibility, with I'm not crazy and I'm going to have a family because that's the word responsibility interpreted very differently than we might do. Yes, yes, responsibility is about taking responsibility for your own feelings. When you feel bad or angry about a situation as it is, no one else created your anger. Only yourself. Maybe there are triggers, but who is making the anger? It comes from you, not from the other person. So your emotion, you are responsible for it. For your actions, for the situation you created. For your words you choose. You are responsible for them. Anything else is more likely to be misinterpreted as an obligation rather than a responsibility. Responsibility is really only what we create ourselves. Yes. So a tramp, a tramp. You might meet him somewhere in the forest. And he's sitting there on a bench. People love it when the cat walks through the and sits there on the bench. And in that case you sit down with him and he tells you, yes, well I quit my job, I sold my house, I sold my car. I chose life on the street. And yes, I am quite happy that I got out of this whole system in this way. Yes, does this tramp take responsibility for his life? Absolutely, I would say. Yes, correct. Takes responsibility for his reality because he made that choice and also knows that everything that happened after that was his responsibility. Because he chose to go this route. Correct, and that means someone who takes responsibility. That doesn't mean that he would somehow have a lot of money or have to have a house and family. So that has nothing to do with it. And that's why it's important to make it clear in a discussion that you see a difference between responsibility and personal responsibility, so that nobody else misunderstands you. Precisely, yes. Now we come to our last point. Our last point would be the solution. How do you create your reality really effectively out of your own creativity and responsibility? Yes, a good question. How do you create your own reality? There are different approaches. Of course, a combination of everything would be best because that's how you create reality really effectively. I would say, first of all, it is of course necessary to identify your own beliefs, for example by choosing a topic, such as money, relationships, work, any topic you are not happy with and your beliefs to write down. It will certainly be a long list, but it is first necessary to find out what do I really believe in. Yes, of course. Don't stick your ass in the camera. So now you can go again. Yes, you can sit there. Yes. Yes. It is therefore important to first identify the misinterpretations. A classic example is, of course, making a list of the positive beliefs on the left. This also includes opinions, interpretations, and beliefs. You can write them all down on the left side. Then write down the positives. In the middle, you write down those who have more of a neutral character and on the right side, you write down your negative beliefs. And then you can make a whole list first, so that you become aware of your beliefs. And when you've gone through that, you take the negative beliefs, write them on the left on a new sheet of paper or on your PC or wherever, and then write on the right what the positive belief could sound like. It is important to always formulate in the present and formulate constructively. Do not incorporate any negations. Yes, another option that you also suggested to me at the time was wallpapering your room with white wallpaper, i.e. wallpaper that you can perhaps remove again and brainstorm with your beliefs. Write a main belief in one place in the middle and around it the secondary beliefs even further around it, then the positively worded beliefs and so on. So you can sort of split your whole room brainstorming with your beliefs into different categories. For example, if you have at least some kind of meditation room or a basement or something. And yes, that also helps a lot to find your way around in your own head. Yes, and of course you should maybe organize your beliefs somehow mathematically. That's exactly what's good. So, on the subject of health, everything that has to do with the health of the body, with the health of the psyche, that has to do with finances, with work, with partnership, is sorted. Family, parents, very important. That you first get an overview and then you can really take a look. Can it all really be true? How did I come to this or that belief? Yes, is it still relevant in my life at all? Yes, that's just faith work. It's a bit time-consuming, that's right. Yes, because many beliefs are drummed into you in childhood or adolescence, but at 40 or 50, for example, they are no longer relevant because that was maybe 40 years ago. They have nothing to do with the current life anymore and you have to filter that out and break it down. How relevant are my old beliefs? Do they really have anything to do with my now life? You've grown up, lived your own life, no longer based on your parents. And you really have to take a look. Yes, is that still true? What was supposedly true at the time? It's also very important to get rid of the old. Yes, in any case. Because our parents always said to us, yes, kid, if you want to cross a street, stand on the edge of the curb. Look left first and then right. And then you're allowed to cross the street if there's no car in sight. You don't do that anymore either, but nowadays it looks different. You just go over it like that. Yes, yes, of course that's true. I mean now. Don't be so strict. Yes, a lot of people don't even look like that, or go over by feel. Or some go by ear. Yes, they don't hear anything. So there is no car, I can walk over there. Or when parents say they are standing at the traffic light, stand on the edge of the curb and wait until the traffic light changes from red to green. Not everyone does it these days. Yes, you walk when it's red or you kick the traffic light until it goes out. There are different options that you can use. So that shows, I just want to say that there are beliefs that we were given in childhood and that may no longer be relevant today or interpreted completely differently than maybe back then. Yes, above all, the parents have them two completely different times than we live today. Yes, or with the food. As a child, you might not have liked spinach at all, and later you suddenly started to like spinach. Why? Why has this belief changed? And there you can already examine conclusions about your own belief system and also determine why one or the other has changed. This is always a change of realities. By the way, in case we haven't mentioned it yet, when you suddenly like spinach, even though you never liked it in your life, but all of a sudden you love spinach. This is a good indication that you have switched reality, even if you have not forced it now. Any change in a belief or belief results in a shift in reality taking place. There are minimal shifts in reality and also major shifts in reality. So that one suddenly finds spinach great would be a minimal change of reality, because all other elements remain in reality, continue to exist. You still have the same parents, the same friends, you have the same apartment, you have the same job, you have the same partner, etc. etc. A major shift in reality could then alter these elements as well. And that makes spiritual dissociation a bit risky. Yes, that's right, because if you overdo it, you can make a bigger leap from reality, with your partner suddenly looking completely different than before, or you suddenly have a different job or other friends. But that happens very rarely. Otherwise, one can use the spiritual dissociation excellently to change a reality or to create minimal shifts in reality. And that is only possible with spiritual dissociation. For example, a job or a change of partner. If you're not that happy with your old job right now, wish for a new job, then you dissociate about what new job you want or something. Yes. Correct. And all you really need to do is say what you want 3 times. I want a new car. And then you dissociate. Let's put it this way, I would say dissociate 1 minute at a time or 2 minutes at a time. And depending on how much energy the reality in which you already own the new car or how it comes about that you receive the new car determines how long it will take. Possibly, if you change reality directly, then the car is right in front of your door. However, if you don't change reality directly, but only little by little, then it may be weeks or months before the car is in front of the door. Yes, and if you want to support dissociation, we now offer you a few other ways to get to your car faster. For example, through affirmations that you say to yourself over and over again every day. Maybe you also speak the affirmations on your cell phone or on a MP3 player. If you listen all night, leave it on during the day. It is also important to feel that reality has already happened. So you already have the new car, you feel, wow, right now I'm going down to a new car. You act like you already have that new car. So feeling and acting accordingly is also very important to favor a change of reality and thus of course to favor dissociation. Because of course with every affirmation, with every feeling and with every action you also feed energy to this reality, in addition to dissociations. And what you direct your attention to is what you create. So if possible, put all your energy and focus on the reality you would like to have. Yes, that's why when you work on the beliefs and not with the spiritual dissociation, it is important that not only one belief stands alone in the room, but you need several beliefs that support each other and just make a system that each justification for the mind fulfilled. If you want your millions in your bank account, then it must also be clear who it comes from, why you get it, what you did for it, etc. etc. And that also applies to everything else, including partnership. If you are totally hot for Heike from next door and you absolutely want to have her as your partner, then this must also be clear to your mind. How did Heike's change of heart come about? Why does Heike suddenly think you're great when she used to throw tomatoes at you, etc.? So everything has to be right when you work with the beliefs. And the more coherent that is, the faster this reality is fulfilled. And with spiritual dissociation, yes, as I said, it depends on how much energy you invest, that is, How much energy you achieve through the use of dissociation in order to be able to switch to this reality. Either slowly through minimal reality shifts into the reality where you want to be, or if you put so much energy into it that you really land in this reality in one fell swoop. Yes, yes. And in closing, all we can say is that the key to a good reality that you have created is, as I said, taking responsibility for your reality, having trust and gratitude. These are the three keys to your reality, no matter how you create it. In the sense, I would say this is the end of the video. Yes, and if you want to delve deeper into the topic of the Matrix and don't feel like looking through all of our 200 YouTube videos to get the right insights or aha experiences, we recommend our free beginner's course, The Matrix. You can find it on www.matrixer.com. You can simply register and take part in our free introductory seminar, The Matrix. This is an 8.5-hour seminar and includes all of our most important videos and topics related to The Matrix. Yes, for all those who have been telling me, get me a free class out there. We have now done you a favor, who have always been behind. A free beginner's course, The Matrix and the Light Trap. Selected and put together just for you. Yes, everyone who just went to our website matrixer.com. They can register there and start the course right away, free of charge. Doesn't cost nothing. I make money. Yes. Exactly. Yes, dear ones. Then let's do the standard here. Subscribe to our channel and hit the bell below all the stories. Give us a like exactly. And you? Yes, you've been at this for so long now. You can also say goodbye. Ciao. Bye bye. Until the next video.